Hey guys, welcome to Channel. Let's check out this video call. It's a another Epic History TV video, man. Okay, so let's watch this playlist. It's only two parts, and this is like the last thing on this channel, Epic History TV channel. Okay, there's nothing more to react to. Okay, so this is the last, and you know, I'm gonna like also like my reactions. I'm soon gonna abandon them. You know, I'm not gonna do any more reactions. After this playlist, I think I'll stop it. But in fact, the fact that I'm even reacting to it now, it's like I'm shocked because I want to stop now. But you know, there's just these two videos, so I'm gonna be reacting to them. Yeah, and you know, this could be one of the earliest goodbyes on my channel. You know, I'm gonna stop reacting to everything. Just I'm just tired, man. I just don't. These reactions don't give me anything, and they're pretty bad, okay? And even though people like it, it's useless, you know? But I think I'm gonna stop reacting pretty soon, okay? But let's watch this part one. This is a new type of thing. I never reacted to this, okay? It's called Islam's Golden Age. We're reacting to some Islam stuff, Islam history and all that. Okay, so Islam's Golden Age, the Abbasid Caliphate. I don't know what that is. There's a description here. In the 8th century Middle East, a new dynasty seized control of... I don't want to be spoiled, so let's just find out, okay? Let's watch this first video. This reaction could last like almost 40-50 minutes because the video is like 23 minutes. I hope not. I'm gonna try my best to make the video smaller. So if I don't talk too much, please forgive me, okay? But there's only one more video left after this reaction, and that's gonna be it. I think I'll even abandon my channel with the reactions and everything, you know? But let's watch it. Rise of the Abbasids, Islam's Mightiest Dynasty. Okay, part one. Let's do it. 3, 2, 1, let's go!
In the 8th century...
Alright, motherfucker. Okay. I hope you... if you like this reaction, please subscribe. But at this point, me asking that, that's not good, okay? Because, you know, I'm not even interested, okay? But whatever, let's go. 3, 2, 1, let's go!
In the 8th century Middle East, a new dynasty seized control of one of the world's greatest empires.
Greatest empires.
The Islamic Caliphate.
Islamic Caliphate.
Though little remembered in the West today, the Abbasids reigned for 5 centuries.
Huh.
They oversaw an era of Islamic military dominance, city building, brilliant scholarship, and technological innovation.
Dang, son.
It has come to be remembered as Islam's Golden Age.
Cool. This. Hey, man, I'm all okay with, you know, Islamic religion making progress in the future and everything. But the terrorism, dude, the problem with the terrorism. And also, like, it's like people that follow Islamic religion, they go extreme sometimes. I don't know. I'm not saying all of them, but it's like blood is part of the Islamic religion. I feel like, you know, bloodshed, you know, I don't know. This might be a wrong thing to say in this reaction, but, you know, I don't know what to say about, you know, because there's a lot of extremism going on and the terrorism, obviously, that's another thing. It's just... I don't know about the Islamic religion. I wish Islamic religion wasn't that, like, extreme, you know, making people go crazy about it, you know, going extreme about it. I wish, you know, because I want everybody, all of us, to live in harmony, but, you know, it's just sad that all kinds of extremism comes from it. It's weird. I don't want to say it, but fuck it. Okay, whatever. Okay, let's go.
Is the story of the Abbasid Caliphate.
Abbasid Caliphate, part one. Rise of the Abbasids. Okay, let's go. Cool.
632 AD.
AD.
In the Arabian city of Medina.
Medina.
The Prophet Muhammad lies dead.
Oh.
His followers, professing the new religion of Islam, sweep across...
The new religion of Islam. I don't know about Islamic religion, dude. I'm okay with Islamic religion if it's normal, if it's not problematic, you know what I mean? But what's happening, even now, it's like, we're in 2024, and we're still having problems with it. I don't know what to say, whatever.
Across the Arabian Peninsula, uniting it under the rule of Abu Bakr, the first caliph, God's deputy on earth.
Dang.
Then they burst upon the world stage, taking on the two superpowers of the Middle East, the Eastern Roman and Sassanid empires. Both are vulnerable after decades of war, and the Muslims wage a stunning campaign.
Dang, man, that's a lot of motivation and a lot of, like, this religion is actually making people want to fucking bolt and go explore, take over places and, you know, build a big-ass kingdom for themselves and everything. And that seems good, but, you know, I don't know. It's Islamic religion, and it's like, it could be very dangerous. We don't know. You know, obviously there's going to be a lot of bloodshed because this is like, what, 600 AD? It's ridiculous. It's going to be a lot of war and everything. And I get it, like, people want, even now, like, even in modern times, I get it, like, people want some, like, a strong focus and motivation and, like, strong, like, complete control over their lives and go achieve whatever they want and everything. I get it. And that's why they follow these, like, hardcore religions like Islam. And, you know, some people follow, like, obviously Christians, the Christianity, you know, and, not like Hinduism or Buddhism, which are, like, peaceful and all that. You know, people don't like that. They want some kind of focus, and they'll follow these, you know, like, ridiculous levels of, you know, religious focus and all that. They want to follow Islamic religion, Christianity and all that. And that's cool. But the extremism, I don't know what to say. But let's not talk too much. Let's get into it.
Winning victory after victory. By 651, they have overrun two-thirds of the Eastern Roman Empire and almost all of the Sassanid Empire. But in 656, the third caliph, Uthman, is assassinated, sparking the first Muslim civil war, or fitna.
Oh, man.
Ali, cousin and son-in-law of the Prophet Muhammad, has the support of the people. But he's opposed by the governor of Syria, Uthman's kinsman, Muawiyah.
Huh.
5 years of bloodshed culminate in Ali's assassination at Kufa.
Dang!
Muawiyah emerges triumphant and establishes a new Umayyad caliphate.
Huh. Dang!
Further conquests help to forge one of the largest empires in history. But it is riven by more civil war. One challenge comes from Hussein, son of Ali, grandson of the Prophet Muhammad. He opposes the succession of Muawiyah's son, Yazid. But in 680, he and his followers are defeated and killed at the Battle of Karbala.
Dang, son.
Supporters of Ali and his descendants will later become the Shiites.
Okay.
They still commemorate Hussein's death each year on the day of Ashura.
Ashura. Dang, son.
The vast Umayyad Caliphate continues to expand. But it contains serious internal divisions. Much of what we know about the Umayyad Caliphate comes from later sources, often hostile. But it seems clear that the small Arab Muslim elite that dominated this great empire was increasingly unpopular with many of its subjects, including some of those later termed Dhimmi. These were non-Muslims, including Christians, Jews, and Zoroastrians, were treated as an underclass and made to pay extra tax.
Okay. Dang,
even those who did convert to Islam, known as Mawali, were often treated as second-class subjects.
Okay. Dang,
decades of discontent were about to boil over.
Shit!
The symbol of Umayyad authority was their white banner.
White banner, okay.
But in 747, a new symbol rises to challenge their rule.
What is that?
The black banners of the Abbasids.
Abbasids. Thanks, son!
If you think you could do a better job building a caliphate or leading a medieval kingdom to glory, Crusader Kings 3. Generous sponsor of this video is the
a
game
sponsor in the middle of this?
Created
the first
by
time
Paradox,
I'm seeing.
Renowned
Epic
for their
TV.
Detailed and sophisticated historical games, Crusader Kings 3 presents you with all the challenges of medieval rulership, from military strategy to economic policy and dynastic alliances. Now,
thanks,
new downloadable content adds royal
go
tours
play this
and
game,
tournaments
I guess.
To the mix, allowing characters to host and compete in that most quintessential of knightly pursuits, the medieval joke.
Honestly, there's a lot of extremism going on. I keep saying that shit. I talk about it a lot now in this reaction. But I want to point out, man, there's a lot of extremism. I'm a Hindu, right? There's a lot of Hindu kidnappings going on. Murders, molestation, all that, you know, it's just, I don't want to point to the Islamic religion, but, you know, they do it. It's just, it all comes from there. And it's like, how can I not look at it and say, oh my God, it has to be the Islamic religion, you know, and it's crazy. And also like when you go search up, who watches the child porn a lot in this world, the fucking Islamic religion. The people from there come up in the top searches. It's like, what is going on, man? I don't know, man. Something is wrong with this Islamic religion. I'm okay with it if it's just nice and normal, you know? I don't know why we have to deal with this extremist shit. I just don't get it, man. And it's gonna keep continue making more extremist people, you know? It's gonna make more terrible fucking weird motherfuckers in the future. It's gonna have, man, and also like obviously the UK and London is being filled with illegal immigrants and, you know, immigrants of all kinds, mostly, most notably the, you know, the Islamic dudes, the Muslims. It's like, what is going on, man? I feel like, you know, this Islamic religion has run its course. It was appropriate for 600 AD time, you know, but not to the modern times. And it just feels weird. Apparently, I've seen some incidents on like news where, you know, like white women, like innocent white women in the subway stations getting molested or, you know, getting, you know, what do you call it? Like stalked or being creeped out by perverts or some shit. It's just weird, man. A lot of murders going on, a lot of rapes. It's weird, bro. I don't know. And these are like illegal immigrants. Most of them are Muslims. It's like, what is going on? I don't know. Please don't be offended. This, and that's why I didn't react to this, because there's so many things wrong with this religion, but whatever. You know.
It's a great way to forge reputation and win favors.
All right.
Or if you're feeling Let's Banquet
go
on
forward.
Steam between the 11th and the 15th of May. So it's the perfect time to try out this richly rewarding medieval strategy game. Use our link in the video description and on screen.
Hey, if you're a Muslim, I apologize, okay? I really do. But man, dude, I don't know about your religion. Maybe it's much better if... I'm not saying that you have to, like, you know, I'm not insulting you or anything, but I think it's much better for the world if we make another religion or something, which is much more peaceful, or join in like Buddhism or Hinduism or maybe Christianity, much better, you know? I just, like, dang, son, I don't know about Islamic religion. I don't know.
Now, to get building your dynasty. Thanks to Crusader Kings 3 for supporting this.
All right, man. The Abbasid Revolution. Let's go. I mean, the history is awesome, okay? Let's do it.
The Abbasids are an Arab family, descended from the Prophet Muhammad's uncle Al-Abbas, from whom they take their name.
Okay. Aye.
They and their supporters believe this blood tie to the Prophet gives them legitimate claim to the title of Caliph.
Caliphate.
Far more so than the Umayyads, whom the Abbasids later portray as decadent and despised.
Okay.
The Abbasids promise a return to true Islam, to correct teachings and moral leadership, and send missionaries and agents out across the Caliphate to spread their message.
Dang, okay.
In 747, with the Caliphate once more racked by revolt and civil war, the Abbasids will seize their chance.
Okay. And also, like, there's, you know, it's like there's this thing called conversions, and you have to convert someone from whatever religion they're following into Islamic religion. That's another big, big problem. And in Islamic religion, it's like in the Quran, it says if somebody doesn't believe, then they're a fucking, you know, like a, what do you call it? Like an infidel, you know, and you gotta beat them or teach them some shit. And there's so many incidents of women not wearing the black tent on their face and, you know, forgetting to wear, so all the men gang up and beat the shit out of the woman and all that shit. It's just too many extreme things. And also, like, I see this in, you know, the conversion thing is in the Christianity too. Wherever Christians go, they try to convert people there. You know, like a devout Christian would always try to convert. And it's like, hey, man, this world is like, no matter how much, even if you convert the whole world into Christianity, there's going to be, you know, separations. There's going to be an out, like a lot of people that will not accept it. Even after, you know, accepting the new role of, you know, Christianity or Islamic religion, being a Muslim, decide to become a Muslim or whatever, you know, it's weird, you know, it's just this conversion thing. I guess you can call it like Abrahamic religion. That's the reason why this thing is, these Abrahamic religions, I guess they're not suited or good for the modern age. You know, I don't know what to say, man. It's crazy. You know, the conversion thing is just crazy to me, you know?
In eastern Khorasan, a general named Abu Muslim, probably a Persian convert, launches a revolt and takes the black banner of the Hashemites as his symbol.
Dang.
The Hashemites, descendants of Hashim, are the extended family of the Prophet, with the Abbasids prominent amongst them. This frontier region, today comprising northeastern Iran and parts of Turkmenistan and Afghanistan, is particularly ripe for rebellion. Here, Arabs and non-Arab converts live side by side. They intermarry and fight alongside each other to defend the frontier.
For
many, the Umayyads are distant and unpopular overlords. What's more, opposition has been stoked for decades by Hashemite agents and missionaries who seek to topple the Umayyads and replace them with one of their own. They have sowed the seeds of revolution. So when Abu Muslim begins his revolt, he quickly attracts followers. Arabs, Persians and Central Asians, many of whom are experienced warriors. And he proves a brilliant commander, winning a series of victories over Umayyad forces and occupying Kufa, capital of Iraq, in 749. The Abbasids now
Also, like, I reacted to other, Epic History TV videos, right, with Napoleon and stuff. Napoleon went into the Egypt and he wanted to become, like a Muslim and follow the book of Quran and everything. And, you know, I admire that, but it's almost like, I don't know about that too. Like, it's like, you're going to follow Quran, you're going to leave everything and you think that's the next way forward and stuff. It's like the next thing that you're going to, your next mission in life is to follow the book of Quran and that's it. It's like, that's what caught me off guard with, it's like this Quran, this book really attracts a lot of people that wants focus, control of their life, and a lot of, you know, motivation and a sense of, you know, like following something which gives them a lot of belief and faith and confidence. And that makes sense, but it's like, I don't know, man, this is, there's a lot of people that even now that, you know, support, are pro-Palestine, pro-Muslim and all that. You know, I'm just saying, think about it before you do that, because this is like Muslim, this is Islamic religion we're talking about. I don't know about that. You know, be careful. Just saying, you know.
Leadership of this revolution. And the following year, therefore...
All this history is pretty cool, and I really like this. And this is the historical, this is what happened, and it's just so amazing. And it's like, it's almost like a fantasy, and I love this, you know. And I wish it was like this, not with the revolutions and the war and everything, but, you know, a peaceful Islamic religion. I would love that. I don't know what happened. Ever since then, I don't know.
Forces meet the army of the Umayyad Caliph, Marwan II, at the Zab River.
Okay.
Most of what we know about the battle that follows comes from Abbasid sources.
Dang,
Caliph Marwan appears to have been a brave but reckless commander, launching a head-on cavalry charge against the Abbasid line. Abbasid historians tell how their own troops, inspired by recent victories, stand fast.
Dang.
Their spear walls repel the cavalry.
Dang, son.
The attack ends in disaster.
In disaster.
Umayyad morale is broken.
Oh,
their
shit.
Army routed. Marwan himself flees the battle, but is pursued and killed in Egypt. Other Umayyads are likewise hunted down and exterminated. Even graves are desecrated. One surviving member of the dynasty, Abd al-Rahman, flees to Spain. Just a few years later, he establishes the Emirate of Cordoba, a second Umayyad dynasty that would flourish in Iberia for centuries.
Okay.
Meanwhile, Abul Abbas al-Safar becomes the first Abbasid caliph.
Dang.
It will take the Abbasids more than a decade to consolidate their hold on power. Al-Safar moves the caliph's residence from Harran to Kufa, closer to the Abbasid power base in Persia.
Dang.
In 751, he sends an army to curb the westward expansion of the Chinese Tang dynasty. The campaign culminates in a bloody victory at the Battle of Talas, but also marks the limit of the Caliphate's eastward expansion.
Okay.
Many
cool
who'd
stuff.
Helped overthrow the Umayyads had sought the end of hereditary rule and a return to caliphs elected from within an elite group. They are to be disappointed. In 754, Al-Safar is succeeded by his brother, Al-Mansur.
Al-Mansur, okay.
The Abbasids will be the new ruling dynasty, and Al-Mansur will prove one of its greatest caliphs.
Caliphs.
His reign begins inauspiciously with the execution of the brilliant and popular general Abu Muslim, now regarded as a potentially dangerous rival.
Oh my God.
Al-Mansur faces rebellion by the Alids, a powerful clan descended from the Prophet's son-in-law, Ali. They resent the growing dynastic power of the Abbasids and press their own claim to rule. Al-Mansur crushes the last major Alid revolt in 762, ushering in an era of stability, prosperity,
and peace. Okay.
He orders the construction of a new capital on the banks of the Tigris River. Officially,
it
is to be known as Madinat As-Salam, the City of Peace.
City of Peace! Cool
it
shit!
It will prove his greatest legacy. A city that will become one of the glories of the medieval world.
Baghdad, okay. Hey, has anybody played the new game called Assassin's Creed Mirage? It's in Baghdad, man. I wanted to play it, but it looked like every other Assassin's Creed, so I didn't play it. And also, like, the money for the... Nowadays, the cost of the games, it's like too much. It's too much cost. And I just know who's going to play, you know, the same Assassin's Creed with shitload of money. You know, you have to buy it and everything. It's not going to happen, okay? Dang. Did you not see how the sun came out of the hiding on Harun's accession and flooded the world with light? Ibrahim al-Mausili, poet and musician. 742 to 804. We're progressing into the, you know, the coming of age, the future, man. We're from 680 to now 800. Crazy. Awesome shit.
In the reign of Al-Mansur's grandson, Harun al-Rashid, the caliphate flourishes as never before.
Okay.
With Baghdad at its heart.
Dang, son.
There are many legends told about Caliph Harun al-Rashid, the rightly guided. He is, after all, a central figure in 1001 Nights, the masterpiece of Arabic literature.
Dang, son, look at
the
this!
The image of al-Rashid that reaches us from such sources is of a devout, wise and beneficent ruler who prayed 100 times a day and each morning gave 1,000 dirhams to good causes.
Dang!
In legend, al-Rashid wandered the streets of Baghdad disguised as a beggar to see how his subjects lived. He was a brilliant horseman and patron of the arts.
Dang!
And a keen chess player.
What a badass, dude!
His court was a place where religion and philosophy could be argued and debated openly.
Shit! Now this is a perfect Muslim. This is how you be. I respect a lot of Muslims and a lot of people that follow the Islamic religion. They're so, like, they're such badasses too. And I love them, man. I respect them so much. It's just some things, you know what I mean? the growing concern and problem that comes with it, especially nowadays. It's like, dang, there's this one incident where, you know, in my India, where these kids, like, these family of people used to live next to these two barbers, and they were Muslims. And one day, like recently, it happened recently, they just went in, locked themselves into this house, their neighbor's house, and slashed the throats of two kids, and they drank their blood, and then they fucking ran away. I don't know what to say about that, you know? And these are like, they said like they always wanted to do that or whatever. One of them got shot by the police. Thank fuck, you know. The other one was apprehended. Dang, man. They even said like we were all okay. We were like nice neighbors to each other. Nobody did anything to us. But I don't know why they would do that though. It's like. See what I'm saying with the Islamic religion? Something is wrong with it, man. It forces people to, you know, it tells people to, you know, have everybody convert to, you know, Islamic religion. And anybody that doesn't convert is a, like an infidel or some shit. And that's the problem with this religion, you know. I respect, you know, Islamic religion and its people so much. But yet this kind of shit keeps happening. And it's like, what the fuck, you know? It's, my God, it's fucking crazy. I just...
on occasion, by a woman.
Dang.
In the caliphate, as in the rest of the medieval...
And no wonder my people from India, the Hindus, they hate the Muslims and the Islamic religion. No wonder. This kind of shit happens every now and then, man. You know, it just sucks. And I wish I could say good things about Islam, and there are good things about the Islamic religion and the Muslims, but my God, dude, I don't know what happened, you know. It has to be the Quran and its text of conversions and the converting people, you know. It tells people to convert and make people like convert others from other religion and all that with force too. And the women are like, they don't have any rights whatsoever. They're just completely covered in a black tent. They're gonna live the rest of their life in it. And I'm shocked to see that some of these progressive women like completely blind motherfuckers. They're in full support of this shit. It's like, dude, life is harsh enough. You don't have to go extreme, you know?
World, few women held high status in their own right. But
the fucking woke crowd is fucking pathetic.
As mothers, wives, and concubines, they could exert huge influence. Al-Khazuran, once a Yemeni slave girl, rose from concubine to caliph's wife, and wielded significant power during the reign of her husband, Caliph al-Mahdi, and son, Caliph al-Rashid.
Awesome.
Famed for her intelligence and learning, she held discussions on policy and military strategy, received foreign ambassadors, and intervened on questions of justice. Much of her own enormous wealth she spent on public works and charity.
Awesome.
Many likened her to a co-ruler. Or the real caliph.
Yeah, this is what I'm talking about.
The success of Al-Rashid's reign was underpinned by efficient government and administration.
Dang.
Much of it was modeled on that of their predecessors, the Sassanids. And they made extensive use of Persian and Central Asian bureaucrats. Of particular note was the Barmakid family.
Also, like, have you seen the old photos of people from Iraq, and women especially from Iraq and Iran or something like that? If you see those photos, they're like, these women are like happy, they're free. They can walk around, they can show their face, they can walk around anywhere, they talk. If you go look at the beaches, they're like, you know, they're wearing bikini and all that shit. It's crazy, man. They were so free back then, but now it's like they have to wear that black tarp over them. And it's like, dude, like, it's like, you don't, if you don't wear a, you know, a burqa, doesn't mean that you're like complete infidel, or you're out there ready to fuck, or doing some degenerate activities, or going crazy and attracting, you know, making men lose their minds, flashing your thighs or whatever. It's not like that. You can still be a religious person, and you can still be a normal person. You know what I mean? You don't have to go like the modern slut route, fearing. Just, you know how it is, right? Nowadays with the hookup culture, it's not like that. You don't have to be that. You'll have the freedom to be anything, and at the same time, you'll have the freedom to be religious, and you will be religious, because a lot of people prefer to be religious than to go out there and become complete whores like the woke crowd and the liberal women crowd, you know. But I just don't get it, man. I don't know why they would follow Islamic religion. I mean, back then, with you just saw that woman, right? She was like ruling, and she did so many charity works, you know. So, you know, women back then had more rights than women now, who are like completely covered, and, you know, they don't have a say in anything, you know. They just get talked over by men and all that, you know. It's just crazy, dude. I'm not saying that, oh, I'm not like pro women or anything, like women fuck men or anything like that, you know. I'm just saying, like, life is harsh, and, you know, let's have equal treatment to everybody. And, you know, when things go crazy, we will be there to protect. We will be there to teach some lesson, or, you know, talk about it. We'll be there to fucking stop horrible things from happening, you know. We're not like completely blind motherfuckers. We have common sense. We have to follow common sense. You know, we don't have to follow a religion in order to stay, you know, religious or whatever. Like, really, we don't have to follow religion to stay, what do you call it? Like stay a virgin or whatever it is, you know, that comes with it. You know, you like, seriously, you know, you get my point, right? Dang.
The Barmakids were descended from high priests of the Buddhist temple of Nobahar, near Balkh, in modern Afghanistan. As early Abbasid allies, they played an important role in government, helping to foster an age of Islamic statecraft imbued with elements of Sasanian Persian culture.
And rich.
They served the Abbasids well for three generations, but the power games of court could be dangerous and unpredictable. In 803, Al-Rashid decided the Barmakids had got a little too big for their boots. The family experienced a sudden and dramatic fall from favour, with many of its members imprisoned or executed.
Oh, shit!
Their demise ended Barmakid control of the post of vizier, a position that had recently emerged at court as the caliph's senior advisor and chief minister. It was a role of enormous significance. Some viziers would later wield so much power, they overshadowed the caliph himself. The fame of Al-Rashid's court spread far and wide. Charlemagne, king of the Franks, Holy Roman Emperor, and the most powerful ruler in Europe, sent several embassies to Baghdad. In return, Al-Rashid sent him dazzling gifts, including perfume, ivory chessboards, a marvellous water clock, and even an elephant named Abul Abbas, which lived for several years at Charlemagne's court in Aachen. Cultural life in the Caliphate, and Baghdad in particular, was remarkably cosmopolitan. The Abbasid court even celebrated Persian holidays, such as Nowruz, Persian New Year. Such open-mindedness helped the Caliphate to flourish.
Also, like, it looks like a utopia. It's so big and vast. It's, man, I want to play that Assassin's Creed game to see how it actually looks like. You know what I mean? Video games are fucking amazing. The future will be filled with, like, the future is going to be, you know, we're going to use video games to do some crazy shit in the future. Let's be honest, because only video games have that level of... The movies don't matter shit anymore. I think video games are the future, bro. Like, I can't wait to see, like, play Assassin's Creed. I'm waiting for a huge discount, but whatever. But look at this shit. It looks so big and vast. It's covered in trees in the middle, and it's like a busy city, you know? It's insane. It looks amazing. It's like... It's monumental. It's insane, you know?
The center of culture, science, arts and medicine.
Amazing.
The center of learning was the city's famous library, Beit al-Hikmah, the House of Wisdom, though little of its function is known today. Here and across the Caliphate, scholars translated classical works from Greek, Middle Persian and Sanskrit into Arabic. Their efforts ensured the survival of countless works that would otherwise have been lost, including those by great figures such as Aristotle and Galen. They also made many of their own original discoveries, knowledge that would come to be much sought after by the medieval West. Baghdad's scholars led the world in many fields. Al-Kindi, known as the philosopher of the Arabs, was a famed polymath who wrote on logic, psychology, astronomy, astrology, and many other topics.
This is awesome, dude.
Al-Khwarizmi's contribution to mathematics led to him being dubbed the father of algebra. The Latinized version of his name, Algorithmus, is the origin of our word algorithm.
I love this translations, you know, celebrating some other type of holidays. And this looks like a great religion. This looks like a great culture. You know, I love this. I want this to flourish. Not the, you know, the book burnings and the forced conversions and all that shit nowadays. It's like, and the things from other parts of history that are like filled with, you know, just extremism and all that. It just, it's ridiculous, you know? But this thing is, this is fucking admiring. This is so amazing to see. This is what I want, you know? This is what I want for you know, the Muslims. This is amazing. This kind of culture, acceptance of everything, tolerance, and at the same time, you know, growth and firm stability and a better progression, you know what I mean? This is how you develop as a nation. And this is probably the golden, like the playlist says, it's the golden age, like literally for the Islamic religion, the Islamists. It's mind-blowing. Dang!
Christian scholar Hunayn ibn Ishaq was nicknamed the Sheikh of Translators for his role translating ancient texts into Arabic.
Amazing. And these people realized that these ancient texts are knowledge from different parts of the world and culture and everything. And they know this and they, you know, translate and make it better for their culture. You know, it's not like they're like, oh shit, this is knowledge from there, we need that shit and we need to take over that place. You know, it's not like that. And I really respect this, you know.
Material culture also flourished under the Abbasids, with the introduction of glazed pottery in the 9th century, allowing new artistic possibilities.
Dang, son!
Many colourful pieces, decorated with animals and Kufic lettering, have been discovered across the former caliphate from this period.
Dang, son! Cool!
The Abbasid caliphate also benefited from its position astride the Silk Roads, the name for the ancient network of trade routes linking Europe and Asia.
Dang.
Valuable imports traveled along this route,
Europe and
such
Asia.
As silk, spices, ivory, gemstones, and even thoroughbred horses.
Cool.
To encourage this trade, the Abbasids built new roads, as well as inns, hospices, and wells for the comfort of travelers.
Huh. Dang.
New ideas and technology also flowed along the Silk Roads. Chinese papermaking techniques first reached the Muslim world under the Umayyads.
That's awesome.
But it was under the Abbasids that paper production really took off. Much cheaper than parchment or papyri, abundant supplies of paper transformed the practice of administration and bookmaking and helped medieval Islam to become one of the most bookish cultures in world history.
Oh my God! That's crazy, man. That's awesome. He adopted a cap on which was written the words "Warrior of the for the Faith, Pilgrim." Al-Rashid prepares to campaign against the Eastern Romans, 806 AD. Al-Tabari, Muslim historian, 839-923. We're heading into more wars. God damn it. All right, let's go. Insanity.
In the 7th century, the first Arab conquests had pushed the frontier of the Eastern Roman Empire back to the Taurus Mountains. Since then, the Caliphate and Empire had been in a state of almost perpetual war, with frequent raids by both sides across the Syrian frontier. Twice the Arabs had even besieged Constantinople itself, but failed to take the great city.
Dang,
son. In 782, Al-Rashid himself had led an Abbasid force as far as the shores of the Bosphorus.
The Bosphorus.
By 804, the Eastern Roman Empire was paying annual tribute to the Caliphate. When Emperor Nikephoros stopped the payments, an Abbasid army crossed the Taurus Mountains and took his army by surprise at Krasos. The Romans suffered a heavy defeat. The Emperor himself was lucky to escape with his life.
Cool.
The cycle of raid and counter-raid continued for years, with Al-Rashid even moving the Abbasid capital to Raqqa, to be closer to the frontier.
Dang,
but this
son.
Fixation on his rival to the west may have blinded the Caliph to trouble in the east.
Oh shit.
In 809, news arrived of revolt in Khorasan. It was while traveling east to face down this rebellion that Caliph Harun al-Rashid became sick and
died.
His 22-year reign would come to be seen as a golden age for the Abbasid Caliphate.
A
time of prosperity, stability, intellectual and cultural achievement.
Insanity.
But al-Rashid's own efforts to ensure a peaceful succession were about to backfire disastrously.
Oh God.
And plunge the Caliphate back into civil war.
God damn it! What?
In the second and final part of Islam's Golden Age, we chart the catastrophe of renewed civil war, the rise of a new caste of slave soldiers, and the devastating onslaught of the Mongols.
Mongols! Holy shit!
Big thanks to our series historical advisor, Professor Antoine Borout of the University of Maryland. You can find out more about Antoine's projects and publications by his university webpage using the link in the video description.
Amazing!
Thanks also to the YouTube channel Patreon for Mukadima for additional help with research. You can watch many great videos about Islamic history on their channel via the link below. Thanks most of all to the Epic History TV Patreon supporters who make this
Patreon
possible.
Deserves
visit
it
our Patreon page to find out how you can support our work, help choose future topics, and get ad-free early access to new videos.
All right, I'm going to stop it here because it's on a playlist, but it's cool stuff. I really respect the Islamic religion and the people of, and their history is like so diverse, so rich in culture, and a lot of tolerance of other cultures, and a lot of admiring, other cultures, and so many they even like celebrated other types of festivals or whatever from other cultures, which is like as tolerant as you can get. It's nice. I like the history and everything, and also like we go pay Epic History TV on Patreon, dude, because this is history. Not many people are doing this on YouTube, and history needs to be told in order to be remembered. If you don't tell history, motherfuckers will act the same, make the same mistakes and go crazy, okay? And we've been making mistakes, and we need to know those mistakes that we made so that we could not repeat it, but I feel like we're gonna lose touch from the past to the future. We're gonna lose touch somewhere, and the future is gonna know that there's a rich history in the past, but they won't give a fuck, and then they don't really read it or learn about it. And I think the future is gonna be a bunch of detached people that will commit the same problems, and it's the history gonna repeat again. I don't know. It's inevitable, I feel like, But the rise of the Abbasids, Islam's mightiest dynasty. I hope you really enjoyed this. And please don't be offended if you're a Muslim, or even if you're like a Christian or any other, maybe you're pro-Muslim or some shit, and you don't like me or what I said. I'm sorry, okay? I'm sorry, Just whatever I said is true, and it's a growing concern, And I hope that this Islamic religion at least changes its text somewhere in the future with the conversions and all that, but I feel like it's never gonna happen, It's much better to sticking... you're not an infidel if you switch your religion. Just saying, it's good for you. I'm just saying, but it's up to you. If you're a Muslim, you'll never leave your Islamic religion, I guess, because that's how the religion is. It won't let you go, So I don't know what to say, but I hope everything turns out to be peaceful in the future. Right now, even now, it's too much and things can go crazy, but I hope everything goes well, but that's it for the reaction. That's all. I hope for the best in the future, and if you're a Muslim, please forgive me and please don't be offended, but please try to understand me as well. Okay, let's have a conversation in the comment section. Okay, so please subscribe, and I'll see you guys later for the next part, which is the last part and probably be the final thing that I will ever react on this channel. Okay, so please subscribe, and if you want to see other stuff, go check my my channel out. There's a lot of, I'll put my previous reactions at the end of this video, and I'll see you guys later. Goodbye.